Well, for more insight into President Putin's thought process in this crisis, I'm pleased to say we're joined by David Speedie. He's a senior fellow at the Carneige Council for Ethics in International Affairs. Thank you so much for your time today. David Speedie, it was reported a couple of days ago that Angela Merkel's takeaway after a conversation with Vladimir Putin is that the Russian president is in another world and is losing touch with reality. Those comments provoked a great deal of debate. Let me ask you for your take. Are the events playing out in Crimea the actions of a rational man?
I think they're not the actions of a rational man, but from the viewpoint of Moscow and his own constituency, the Russian public, Putin has more or less achieved what he set out to achieve. You know, it was Ronald Reagan, actually, who said that his ambition was not to make America loved or hated, but respected. And what Putin has done in his time as president and, of course, as prime minister, but is essentially to seek to restore prestige that was lost during a disastrous decade of Russia, for Russia in the 1990s. And to that extent, you know, it's a mission accomplished for Putin. The other thing is that, of course, from what we just saw, Crimea is a vastly different situation from Syria, from Russia's point of view, and has to be seen in that way.
As you talk about Putin being in pursuit of greater prestige for his country, let me ask you this. Do you feel that his intention is to hold on to Crimea, to annex it to Russia?
No, I think the first part of what he must do is to realize that, 30% of Ukraine is populated by either people of Russian origin or actual Russians living in Ukraine. Crimea, in particular, has at least 100,000 active military or retired military personnel. Crimea goes back 200 years with Russia when they essentially captured it under Catherine the Great from the Ottoman Republic. So Crimea has a very special part in the Russian soul. And of course, it was only as recently as 1954 that an internal transfer was made from Russia to Ukraine. But of course, that was within the Soviet Union. So it's a very complex historical, cultural, demographic picture here that I think we have to at least pay attention to.
Yeah, I mean, the point has been made that, like it or loathe it, Russia and Ukraine are entwined historically, culturally, economically, geographically. So I guess my question with that, as you lay out the history, is how do we move forward from here?
How we move forward from here, of course, is to defuse the current situation, because, as you say, every wise observer I've heard, whether they lean more towards the West's version of events or Russia's, agrees that Ukraine must have at least a non-confrontational relationship with Russia, regardless of what happens from the immediate crisis. That's why the meeting of the foreign ministers in Brussels is at least encouraging. I think also there's a role for the UN in this as the one broker who can really bring the sides together to defuse the current situation, to make sure that the rights of the Russian population of Ukraine, rights of language, rights of worship and other things are protected. These are essential.
As you talk about de-escalating this crisis, I've got to ask you before I let you go about your thoughts on some of the rhetoric that has been flying about the past couple of days. Just yesterday, former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton reportedly said that the moves being made by Putin are similar to those of Adolf Hitler and the Nazis back in the 1930s. Give me your thoughts when you hear comments like that, going around at a time like this.
I'm afraid our diplomatic record, I mean the U.S.'s diplomatic record in this whole situation, has been unfortunate, from comments about Rocky IV by Senator Kerry and now this really, frankly, ridiculous statement by former Secretary and former Senator Clinton. It's particularly unfortunate given the fact, of course, that part of the Ukrainian memory, and especially the Ukrainian memory in the eastern part of the country, is of a period of collaboration with the Nazis in World War II. That is a period of not too distant history, and so this is a particularly unfortunate, evocative image for them to hear.
David Speedie, great to talk to you on this day. David Speedie, senior fellow at the Carneige Council for Ethics in International Affairs. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you very much.